Hello everyone. So in today's class we will talk about absolute and conditional series. What are this series and question is why do we need this? So before going to the concept of this and why do we need this, let me give you some kind of motivation that why do we need this. Okay, so see, when you are in finite numbers or when you add finitely many numbers, for example, if I want to add 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 9 plus, if I want to add these 10 numbers, you add in any order, answer does not matter. What is the answer? N into N plus 1 by 2, so 55. So sum of first 10 natural numbers is nothing but 55. Now you add these 10 numbers anyhow, so 10 plus 4 plus 7 plus 1 plus whatever, you still get the answer 55. So if you rearrange the terms and then you add these numbers, you still get the finite answer. That means what I'm saying, first, or why this is true, because of the associativity property. You add two numbers a plus b, then you add the third, is same as you first add b and c and then you add a. So in finite numbers, you add the numbers in any order, it does not affect the answer. So these are the good things which happens when you have only finitely many numbers. So now one can ask that if I have infinitely many numbers, like if I have a series, then will my answer change if I add the numbers in any different way? So that was the question which was asked by Riemann, and answer is yes, your answer will change in case of series. So if you have a series and if you add the, you don't have freedom to add the number in any order you want. Under some cases, yes, we will come to it later. But let me tell you this with the help of an example. If I take a series as 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 and so on. So what is the series? Series is summation minus 1 raised to n plus 1. N is running from 1 to infinity. So this is the series I have. Now question is, what is the sum of this series? Whether is this series convergent or divergent? First of all, one can apply nth term test and one can see that this is a divergent series because limit of an as a sequence does not exist. So it's a divergent series. But if you observe, so answer is infinite. But if I do little bit of smartness, what I will do is I will add the series this way. What is 1 plus minus 1? This. If I do the bracket in this way, what I'm getting? 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus so on is nothing but 0. My SN will come out to be 0 and limit of sequence of partial sum is 0. So one way I was getting by nth term test, it's a divergent series here. So that's what, see the importance of bracketing. If I'm doing this way of bracketing and then I'm adding this infinite terms, I'm getting 0 as an answer. Why 0? I can also get 1 as an answer. So what was the series? 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1. You do the bracket this way. So this is 1 plus, what is this? 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0. What is this? Finally, the sum is 1. So see, you can do many this weird kind of things in series. You change the bracket and you might get any other answer. One can also get 1 by 2 as an answer. How do you get 1 by 2 as an answer for this series? So for what is my S? It is 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1. It's just the trick I'm doing. So you add, so this is your S. You write S from here. 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1 and so on. Now you add. What is S plus S? 2S. This is 1, this is nothing, that means you treat as 0, 1, minus 1 plus 1, 1 minus 1, minus 1 plus 1, everything goes away. So what is left? 1. So what is your S? 1 by 2. So you can do any such weird kind of things in series and you can get whatever sum you want. Like one of the very standard series, one is one more thing. I mean, nice series, that's why I want to share with you. So if you take this series, 1 plus 1. Minus half, sorry, you take SS, 1 minus 1 plus half minus half plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 4 minus 1 by 4 and so on. So
So if I do the bracketing in this way, 1 minus 1 plus half minus half plus 1 by 3 minus 3 in this way, what will be the sum? Answer is 0.
Okay, good.
Now, if I take first two positive numbers and then the first negative, then the remaining two positive numbers, then the first, then the negative, then remaining two positive numbers, means I'm taking two positive, then a negative, two positive and then a negative. So this is how I'm rearranging the terms. Okay, so this is the first term, this is the second term, this is the third term, this is fourth, this is fifth, this is sixth. So two positive, one negative, two positive, one negative. And actually one can prove that the sum of this series is nothing but ln of 2. If I take 3 positive, 1 negative, 3 positive, 1 negative, means 1, 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3, minus 1, plus 1 by 4 plus 1 by 5 plus 1 by 6, minus 1 by 2. So if I take 3 positive, then 1 negative, if I go in that way, in that scenario, I get answer as ln of 3. This is a very nice generalization. The reference is, you can just Google it out, Riemann representation theorem. You get a Wikipedia page, you read that. You will see the generalization of what I'm talking right now. So anyway, so what is the main thing I want to say? Whenever you have infinitely many terms, whenever you are adding infinitely many numbers, your addition, the way you are adding the numbers matters a lot. It's not like you do in the finite case. In infinite case, this rearranging matters. So then the question is, for which series the rearranging matters? Means for every series this is true, that if I add in any order I get different answers. So answer is no. So that's what Riemann proved. So what did he prove? So to see the statement of a Riemann, we should know two concepts. Among them, the first concept is absolutely convergent series. So when you call a series to be absolutely convergent. So now you know why we are studying this concept. We are studying this concept to answer one simple question, that for which series, if I add the numbers in any order, I will get the same answer, and for which series, if I interchange the order, I may get different answer. So this is the question, and the answer is nothing but the theorem by Riemann, which is called as the Riemann representation theorem. And that theorem involves the term absolutely convergent and conditional convergent theorem, conditional convergent series. So if you have a series summation an, when I will call this series to be absolutely convergent series, this series is called as, it's called absolutely convergent series if you take the absolute values of the terms, you take mod of an, and if this series converges, that means if the series of absolute term converges, then we say that the given series also converges. So that's what the name itself suggests. You take the mod. So if you take mod of all the numbers, and then the series which you get, you check this behavior. If this series converges, then we say this series converges absolutely. And what is the definition of conditional convergent series? A convergent series is said to be conditionally convergent if you, when you take its absolute value, then that series diverges. Okay, so when you call something to be absolutely convergent, if you take summation of mod an, you take the absolute values of the nth term of the series, and if that series converges, we call it's a absolutely convergent series. And in the conditional, what I'm saying, a convergent series. Okay, so make sure the definition is clear. Here I'm, for conditional, I'm saying a convergent series is said to be conditionally convergent if the mod diverges. Here I'm not saying a convergent series. You take any series, when you will call it absolutely convergent if summation mod n converges, whereas for conditionally convergent series, the condition is that series has to be first of all convergent, and then you check its mod. If its mod is divergent, then the series is conditionally convergent. So actually, why we don't say here a convergent series an, because if a series is absolutely convergent, then this automatically becomes convergent. So what I want to say is, so in the definition of absolutely convergent, we don't say a convergent series. Why so? Because there is a very nice theorem. the theorem says if series AN converges absolutely, then summation AN converges.
Means you take the mod of AN, if that is convergent, that means the series is converging absolutely, then the given series itself converges. So that's why we don't write in the definition of absolutely convergent that a convergent series and so on. Whereas in conditionally convergent, this is not true. So therefore in conditionally convergent, we precisely say a convergent series is said to be conditionally convergent. So I hope you have observed that difference. And this is the reason that why in absolutely convergent, we don't write a convergent series AN. Okay, so the proof is also very easy. See, your AN is always less equal mod of AN, because here you can have minus sign. If they're plus, then both are same. If here you have minus sign, then obviously this will be bigger. And this is greater equal minus of mod N. So this is always true. So if I add mod AN to both sides, what I get? This less equal AN plus mod AN less equal mod AN 2 times mod AN. So this is what I have. Now what is given to me? The series is converging absolutely. So summation mod AN converges. That is given to us. So this implies what? 2 times summation mod AN also converges, because scalar multiplication of a convergent series is convergent. But this implies what? Summation of 2 mod AN converges. So from here I have the terms are non-negative and the bigger series is convergent. Therefore by direct comparison test, summation AN plus mod AN is convergent. So here I am using direct comparison test. So what I am getting, what I have summation mod AN is convergent, and using DCT I am getting summation AN plus mod AN is convergent. So now this is convergent, this is convergent. We saw the arithmetic operation on convergent series. What does it say? That subtraction is also convergent. So what is the subtraction? AN plus AN mod, subtract this, minus mod AN. This is also convergent by arithmetic operation on convergent series. But this is nothing but summation AN. So what do I get? The series converges. So therefore if a series is converging absolutely, then the series itself converges. So this is a very important theorem. Many times it's difficult to prove that the series is convergent. But then once you prove it is absolutely convergent, your job is done. So for example, if I take the series summation minus 1 raised to n upon sin n upon n square. Now I want to check whether this is convergent or what, absolutely convergent or what. So obviously I cannot apply direct comparison, limit comparison, root ratio, because there are minus sign in the term, minus sign in the series. Can I apply alternating series? No, because sin 1, sin 2, sin 3, sin 4, they don't behave alternately, right? I mean, you have plus minus sign in between. So you can't even apply alternating series test. So if I want to check the convergence or divergence, what I will do is, I will check whether you take the summation of mod of this. Which is nothing but minus goes away when you are in mod of sin n upon n square. So you check whether this is convergent or not. So what is my mod of an? Mod of an is nothing but mod of sin n upon n square. Now you check whether this is a convergent or not. So how will you check? Now here I can apply direct comparison test, because now this terms are, I am taking mod. So this term, so your mod an is less equal 1 by n square, because mod sin is less equal 1, right? So this is less equal 1 upon n square, and the summation 1 upon n square is a convergent series by p series test. So by direct comparison test, so by DCT, summation mod an converges. That means what? This series is absolutely convergent. And just now we saw a theorem that if a series is absolutely convergent, then the given series is also convergent. So therefore by previous theorem, summation an converges. So this is how that theorem is useful many times. So even I can't apply alternating series test, but then I can take the mod and then I can conclude that it's a convergent, and therefore by previous theorem this series is also convergent. So even this will act as a counter example to the converse of Leibniz test. One can see that. So anyway, so that's how one can use, this is how one can use the previous theorem to check the convergence of a series. If you recall our previous example, summation minus 1 raised to n plus 1 ln of n upon n minus ln of n. This example I took in my previous session, we showed that this is a convergent series. We showed that this is convergent by alternating series test. We proved precisely that this is a convergent series. Now what can you say about mod of this? When I take the mod, minus sign goes away. So mod of ln of n upon mod of ln minus n minus ln of n. All these are positive, so I can remove the mod, because my ln is less than n, so therefore this is positive, so I'm simply removing mod because all the terms are positive. Now this is my mod an. Now I want to check whether the summation mod an is convergent or not. So how do you check? So as I told you last time also, you see log, throw away log. What is left? If I throw away log, what is left is you take your bn to be 1 by n. Do you know which one is bigger? Right now I don't know which one is bigger. Okay, so no problem. Go by limit comparison. You can't go by direct comparison. So go by limit comparison. Limit n going to infinity mod an upon bn. I can apply direct limit comparison because all the terms are positive. This is positive, this is positive. So I can apply limit comparison test. You apply this thing. What answer you will get is, you apply L'Hopital rule. You will get answer to be infinite. You do this, okay? By L'Hopital rule, your answer will come out to be infinite. And what is summation bn? Summation bn is divergent. Why? Because of p series test, because my p is 1. So therefore, by limit comparison test, whenever the ratio is infinite and the denominator series is divergent, therefore by limit comparison test, summation mod an is divergent. And hence, this series is a conditionally convergent series. Because this series is converging, but when you take the mod of this series, it is nothing but a divergent series. So this is an example of a conditionally convergent series. Let's take one more example. The standard harmonic series, alternating harmonic series, which we took in the last lecture we saw. So summation minus 1 raised to n plus 1 upon n. In the last session, in the last lecture we saw that this is a convergent series by alternating series test. So now if you take the mod of an, what is mod of an? 1 by n, because this minus goes away. And what is summation mod an? And this is what? This is a divergent series by p series test. So this is alternating harmonic series is also an example of a conditionally convergent series. That the series is converging, but when you take the mod, it is a divergent series. The one more example which we took, summation minus 1 raised to n plus 1, 0.1 raised to n. If you are feeling lazy to check that this is a convergent series by alternating series test, what smart trick you can do is, you take the mod of this. What is mod of this? It is nothing but mod of 0.1 raised to n, because this minus sign goes away in mod. So this is nothing but 1 by 10 raised to n. So what do you know about summation 1 upon 10 raised to n? This is a convergent series, right? Why? Because this is a geometric series. So since summation of mod an convergent, therefore it is absolutely convergent series, and therefore the theorem which we just now mentioned, the given series is also a convergent series. So either you can use alternating series test, or this trick will also help you many times, that you take the mod, if that is convergent, you can directly use the theorem that if a series is converging absolutely, then the series itself converges. So that's all about absolutely convergent and conditionally convergent series. And now let's come to the main task. Why we started this lecture? We started this lecture because we wanted to know the answer for which series the sum will not change if I rearrange the numbers. So that's what the Riemann representation theorem is. You can see the actual statement from the book or from the Google anywhere. What does the statement say is that if an is converging absolutely,
If a series converges absolutely, then rearrangement does not matter. That means what?
If you have a series which is converging absolutely, then you add the numbers in any order you want, whichever order you want, you add the numbers, you will always get the same answer. Your sum of the series will always be same. And whenever it is conditionally convergent, and if
summation an is conditionally convergent, then rearrangement matters.
That means what Riemann proved, that for conditionally convergent series you can rearrange the number and you can get whatever number you want, and is something called as Riemann paradox. You can just Google it out. But anyways, for conditionally convergent series, what he said, you can rearrange the terms in whichever manner you want, and you can get that number. Whereas for absolutely convergent series, you rearrange the number in whatever manner you want, you will always get the same answer. So this is what the answer is to our question which I raised at the start of the lecture. So that's why we study absolutely convergent and conditional convergent series, because those are the series which answers our question that whether the rearrangement matters or not. So I hope the statement of the theorem is clear. My suggestion will be, again, you simply just visit Wikipedia page on this, where you can find the exact statement of the theorem. And if you have any further doubts, you can ask me in the comment section. Thank you and have a nice day.